We have seen a few Japanese pitchers sign big contracts this offseason. Who is next? JP Morosi, good morning to you. You ready to top Warren Moon? I mean, geez. Wow. Good morning to you. We saw Shota Imanaga in the WBC, 30 years old, 5'10", and the posting window, as I understand it, is coming to a close. What does that mean? Explain it for us.
Lauren, good morning. This is the week for Shota Imanaga to sign his Major League Baseball contract. The deadline is Thursday evening, our time, Eastern time here in the U.S. And so as a result, things are heating up for Shota Imanaga. I was told yesterday, still five teams engaged on varying levels for Imanaga, who started and earned the win for Team Japan against Mark DeRosa's Team USA in the World Baseball Classic gold medal game. There you see it. He's really in his prime, Lauren. 30 years of age, very efficient pitcher. You see what he was able to do this past season with 148 innings pitched. One team I'm watching carefully here, the Los Angeles Angels. We know, of course, they've been looking for different ways to add to their rotation. They've been involved in the pursuit of Imanaga at different times, according to multiple accounts and reports. They are among the finalists to sign him. And so as the Angels look for that signature move this offseason, of course, losing the iconic Shohei Ohtani to their geographic rivals with the Dodgers, that could be a great fit for the Angels to sign Imanaga again before Thursday, 5 p.m. Eastern time.
Efficiency is the word. You said it, and the word I keep hearing when talking about Imanaga. The Mariners made moves. We said that, gosh, a time or two. Gone is Robbie Ray. Of course, they could use the financial flexibility. Who's next, or are they complete, JP?
Lauren, usually when it comes to a Jerry DePoto team, any day that ends in Y is a good day for a trade. And so Friday was one of those days, a couple different deals. Ray to San Francisco, Mitch Haniger back to Seattle, along with Anthony DeSclafani, a Florida Gator, Lauren, as you know well. And then the other deal the Mariners made with the Tampa Bay Rays, they were able to bring in Luke Raley. By the way, I love that Sean Casey comparison in the couple segments ago. Jose Caballero, I love that. He goes to the Tampa Bay Rays. And let's take a listen here to what Jerry DePoto said over the weekend in explaining the rationale behind the twin trades on Friday.
We went into the offseason with a pretty clear shopping list, the things that we wanted to get done, you know, with adding Mitch Garver, bringing back Mitch Haniger, adding DeSclafani, bringing Luke Raley into the mix. And then we made a trade earlier this offseason to acquire Luis Urias from the Red Sox. We've done a little bit of just about everything we wanted to do, and now we still have some, you know, some ability over the course of these next 4 or 6 weeks, just to go get better, find a way to add, whatever that is. If it's in our bullpen, if it's another bat, just some way that we can improve the club. But I do feel like we have a good team on the field, and that was an important step.
The Mariners, Lauren, they talked a lot early on this offseason, wanting to bring in some elements to the lineup that make them a little harder to pitch to. Maybe a little bit higher on base, a little bit less swing and miss. On measure, they've been able to do that with the moves that they have made. And I was curious to hear Jerry DePoto's comments about the potential of additional moves. You do wonder, now that you have added in a right now pitcher in DeSclafani, could you potentially move one of your younger arms? We've talked about this before, like a Brian Wu or a Bryce Miller, for an impact bat with some control. Jonathan India comes to mind because the Mariners do have potentially a need at either second base or third base, depending on how things play out. Of course, Eugenio Suarez is no longer part of the everyday lineup. So this is a very, very competitive American League West with the reigning World Series champs in Texas, Houston, the perpetual ALCS entrants. But Seattle, I think, Lauren, they are a better team now than they were when the season ended. And I think that's a great compliment to their front office. There was some thought early on they were going to be very aggressive in free agency. It turns out, for budgetary reasons, it was more of a trade type of an offseason. I think Jerry DePoto, Justin Hollander, they've done a very good job of upgrading their club in the last couple months.
Yeah, H and Matt said while you were talking, their offense significantly better. Robbie Ray to the Giants. Every offseason, I feel like we have these grand plans for a big-time name in San Francisco, right? Going back maybe 5 years. Some big new, they've made some big additions, JP.
They have. And I do think that they've been involved. We talked about Imanaga earlier. They also, with the way that they've handled things this offseason, they were able to bring in, we just saw the news there with Robbie Ray. They also have Cobb potentially coming back at midseason. Like, those are two really important in-season moves to where you might still see them add a little bit of pitching. Stroman has been mentioned there as well. But Jung-Woo Lee is the big acquisition for the San Francisco Giants. The question I have, when you talk about lineup construction, Wilmer Flores might be their cleanup guy. They're really relying a lot on Lamont Wade Jr. Do they have enough big-time power in the middle of the lineup to compete with the Los Angeles Dodgers atop that division? My answer to that right now is no. And that's where they have to find a way to get, whether it's, you think about a Jock Peterson is still out there, a Justin Turner is still out there, JD Martinez is still out there. There are some significant bats. Rhys Hoskins is still out there, a Northern California native. I look at this club, Lauren, and there are enough bats on the free agent market still in what's been, I think, a difficult market to get a long-term deal. We saw that with the Hernandez deal that he signed with the Dodgers. So there are enough bats out there that when you look at what the Diamondbacks have done, the defending National League champs, the Dodgers, how great they are, the Giants, Lauren, if they're going to make that next move, to me, they've done enough on the rotation for now. They need some more dependable bats in the middle of that lineup.
Yeah, it's still time to get better. Jerry DePoto was talking about it with regards to his team. Sean Manaea left the Bay, went to Queens. It's crazy to look at the Mets rotation, how they constructed it last year, right, heading into that season as opposed to now. How would you compare it, JP?
Well, Lauren, it's a great point that you make about the difference in thought, because you had the future Hall of Famers in it a year ago at this time with Scherzer and Verlander. Now it's more of a short-term, find some good bounce-back candidates. Manaea was a little bit of a bullpen, a little bit of a starter this past year. I love the Hauser and Taylor acquisition. Of course, David Stearns knows both of them very well from Milwaukee. They add Bader's glove in center field. They add Severino. They believe he's going to be able to bounce back. So I think they've had a very solid offseason. The thing that I wonder about, Lauren, in the weeks ahead, where are they on a Pete Alonso extension? Now, Alonso, of course, represented by Scott Boras. At the moment, Scott is very involved in finding spots for Blake Snell and Jordan Montgomery and Rhys Hoskins, a lot of the main free agents. But at some point, whether it's mid-February or during spring training, the Mets have to decide where they're going with Alonso and if they're going to extend him. Because guess what? Yeah, I do believe, Lauren, that there's a lot of great baseball writers in New York. And let's imagine a world in which Alonso is not extended.
It makes
if the Mets
look
get
bad,
off to a slow
Maddie.
Start, get
He's
ready.
Looking.
Get ready for May and June.
I think
there
it
you
does.
Go. There you go. So I would say May and June, if the Mets are not in a strong playoff position, a lot of trade rumblings around Citi Field with Pete Alonso. So that's going to be a major story. Maybe not this week, Lauren, but at some point, once Scott Boras' free agents all sign, then that negotiation could begin on the Pete Alonso extension.
My Mets fans, very patient with Pete news, as you can imagine.
Very patient, Lauren.
JP Morosi,
patient.
I appreciate the time. As always, we'll talk to you later on in the show. Warren Moon to JP Morosi seamlessly. Maddie B.
Thank you.
Muchos,
thank you.